Good day from the Word Bible Software. Today we're going to be looking a little bit again at some sermon preparation. We'll be covering 1 Peter 5, 1 through 5, using some Greek phrasing. Some specific tools of interest during this time will be Robinson morphology. And just to give you an idea, I have it built into my pop-up here. I'm going to switch it to English. It's set inside here in your morphology codes. So we go in here, I'm going to switch it over to the English one. And I have it set as a pop-up so that I can quickly and easily see where I am at. I have another version here that I prefer to use. There we go. Let's jump over to 1 Peter 5, 1 through 5. Note, some things are written here in Spanish because this will wind up being a Spanish message in the long run. But as we do this particular video, we're going to be covering it in English. So let's go down. We have some words. You can do a quick look over and maybe a click on the word. I got some different dictionaries open up. Here's Thayer, which is a more recent release of Thayer. It's the full version. It's not the abridged version. And it's a Greek one. It's available in the free to you module section. Here's a VGNTS that you can purchase at thewordbooks.com. AMGL, also available and free to you through AdTitles or at theword.net. And BDAG, which is available at thewordbooks.com. Now, I'm going to jump right in here. So let's go in here, and I have my text already copied out. I'm using the Byzantine, and you just a little bit of information for it. It is the Greek New Testament, the original Greek Byzantine majority text with Strong's morphology, and it has the NA27 and Byzantine variants. It's the Robertson Pure Point Edition. This is the most recent one that we have out, copyright 2019. So this is definitely one I'd recommend using. We're also going to be looking at, possibly later, the Society of Biblical Literature, Greek New Testament, and also includes the Morph GNT. Let's continue. Let's jump in here, and something called phrasing. I'm going to bring it up here in a module that we've built, and it's available at thewordbooks.com. And in here, we have the Greek text option. Under the Greek text option, we have something called phrasing. This is after you've done your grammar. We're going to kind of use it grammar along with phrasing today. And in here, this depends on your understanding of Greek. It's best to do your phrasing in Greek, but if you need to wait until you get to English phrasing, that's another section in here. You can do that. You'll divide, basically in this, you will divide the passage into phrases, which will help you understand the overall structure of the passage. Some people liken this somewhat to diagramming. I like this because it's a little more visual. Well, it's also visual, but it's also a little quicker than going the diagram route. And you can get into it further here. Well, let's go down in here. We have subconjunction, nominative phrases, adjectives. We have verb phrases. We have also here an accusative phrase. And then nominative phrase along with this is some more. And then here is the dative phrase. And these are these words, a nominative, verb, a dative, accusative. You'll find those come up in the Robinson morphology. I'll tuck that back out of the way there. Now let's get in here. And I'm just going to simply go down through the text. We have presbuteros. And I'll jump over here. It tells me it's an adjective. It's an accusative. So an accusative is a direct object in English grammar. But we're working on Greek grammar here, but if that's an easier phrase for you. So presbuteros in whom in. Let's actually reverse that back. And we need to know what the parakalou is. That is a verb. So that one jumps right here. And we're going to give it a highlight because it's an indicative verb. We're going to bold it and underline it. It's first person for those interested. And then here we have a omicron. And this usually represents a nominative type here. So it's a definite article nominative, which tends to be the subject of the sentence. I like to jump these over one. And in here, we will just bold those. Kai martus. And what is martus? So we look here. It is also in the nominative case, so we'll bold it as well. So remember up here, this was in the accusative case, so we jump that over too. So you'll see as we go down phrasing how it'll adjust and get into different things here. Tus en humin. So, and tus is an article. It's very interesting. It looks like we have a little bit of a note here. There's some variant here. Let's look at that in SBLGNT. And, yep, there it is. It's therefore. So, interesting here. Tus. So, we're going to jump that over. We'll not get any so much into the translation right now. And then this is a dative phrase, which is the indirect object. So, the... And then we have this, and Martus, if you're just interested in a little bit of brief translation, so the elder or fellow elder, because sum presbyteros, kai Martus, and witness of the, so you have an article here and the article it connects to. We're going to leave it like that. Sometimes it's easier just to leave those in there because you could jump it out this portion and we're going to see actually here. So this would be like so of Christ, and then we have here, and it would be the sufferings of Christ, or of the sufferings of Christ, something like that. Okay, and we have a comma. Give a little break. We have another ha. That'll be the subject again. Kai tes melises apokrututhai. So this one right here would be a verb. We'll double check it here. Let's check this one right here. It is a infinitive verb. So we put it like this. And down here, doxes kainonas. So we have here, right here, this one is GSF, which is genitive, singular, feminine, which can be possessive or a description, like of something rather. And then let's see here, we have doxes, glory. So this is actually connecting all the way to the word glory, probably. And this is the subject here. So, and this actually probably connects all the way up to this right here. I'm going to jump the verb back over, even though it is an infinitive. And this one's a little interesting here. So we're going to jump this over to the genitive area, and here also the genitive area. The chi. Now, is it connecting to this verb and this verb, or is it connecting these two together? It probably is going to come out more like an also, so it's probably connecting the subjects together. It is a conjunction. Continuing on, we have a semicolon here in Greek, and now we come down here to poinate to en humin poimenoin, of God. So let's look here at this. Jumping down to the second verse, we have a verb. And this verb is roughly tend or feed. There we go. And we're going to jump this over. Now we're not, like I said, we're not getting way into the translating today. And we have here an accusative or the direct object. To in whom. And that is actually a dative inside that. So we'll look at that. And then of God would be a description of that. So we'll just jump it over one, indicating it's under this area here. And if you're interested, we can go ahead and do brief translation here. The flock. So basically, the flock among you of God. And we'll just actually move this back up in here. So the flock among you of God, basically. And that's kind of very rough. You'd probably wind up finishing it out in a... There we go, put that there. Probably God's flock among you. Something like that. Let's continue on. We have here a ES. That tends to indicate a plural nominative. So, epsilon sigma. Episcopudentes. And we go in here. And we look at this one briefly. It is a nominative, plural masculine. It is then a This would be a noun. Well, actually, technically, it's a participle. And as a participle, it can come across as either... Whew. It can come across kind of in the adverb or the adjectival situation, depending on how it connects in. And it's connected into a verb, and you can see the mood, it's a participle. But we do know it's in the nominative, so we put it there. We have another comma here. We're going to jump this down one. And let's look at this. Anagekastos. And we'll look at that one briefly. It is an adverb, so we're going to jump that over one more. It's kind of how I like those. And but now we're going to jump this to the start, because the conjunctions, we'll try to keep the conjunctions with what they do. So is it like a verb, but, and now we'll see if this is a verb. Let's check it out. Akousios, it's an adverb. Okay, so we're going to now need to get jump back here and determine if this but here, which is a conjunction, connects as the, to these two adverbs. Let's look. Let's do a little bit of translation. By force or constraint or by compulsion. So we're just going to, so not by compulsion. Just going to briefly put that in there just to take a look-see. But, and then it goes in here. What do we have here? Voluntary or willingly. So it does appear that this but is connecting the two adverbs. So we'll put that there and you can kind of check it out. Now continuing on, nor, and we have a mede, and mede is kind of a combo. It is a conjunction or conjunction participle. It's combined with a negative and it makes basically a no or and not or neither. So when we're going to go in here, and the question is now where is this one? Well, we will find out shortly as we look at this. Asico querontos. Let's look at that one. That's another adverb. So then that tells us we have the conjunction joins those adverbs. And if you want, you can get into it. Do we need to know it for this, the phrasing today? From eagerness or from base gain? Let's look here. Greedily. These, like I said, these are just really rough. But, and then we have another but. Huh, let's see, is that another adverb in there? We'll find out here using our Robertson morphology. It is another adverb, and there we go, willingly. And so, and you can kind of see that these do kind of connect together. But if you really look at now a little bit of punctuation, remember punctuation was added for basically future understanding. But see this semicolon? Let's jump separate them there. So neither greedily, but willingly. Not by compulsion, but willingly. Neither greedily, but willingly. And then we have another neither in here. Neither as... And this is an adverb, but it's in a different, it's a different situation. Neither as and now this one, see here, this is a participle, and remember that one, what was that, was roughly overseen. Let's put that one there, overseen. Like basically this is somebody, remember, it's talking to the elders, the overseers, overseen. And then this will connect all the way to this nominative case, because this is also in the nominative case. So basically contrasting the two subjects there. And there we go. Oops, let's see, we are right here. And neither as, looking down to this, stooping down or exercising dominion over. This is a participle. It's in the nominative plural masculine. Basically, subduing, subjecting. we'll just put it like this for now. Subduing. And you could get into this and what this is would be your final. Let's see, that doesn't have it there. How's a good way to bring this in across into English? Exercising lordship. There we go. Because that's not the role of the elder. Of the, and did we see this one earlier? So we're going to go, and we're going to just actually jump this in here. Of the Kleikron. No, not there. Let's look again. And it comes across as an herencia. This could be a farm inheritance. Could actually be coming across as maybe inheritances. But remember, we don't want to get too far caught into these, into translating today. Okay, could be the inheritors, perhaps. But, and we have that, once again, that same conjunction. And tupoi, and the oi indicates it's a nominative plural masculine as well. Tupoi. And we go in here just a little bit further, and it says that, which keeps us there. And let's see here. Tupoi. Genomenoi. So that's actually going to be, it's also another participle. And this is a period, so we're going to break it a little bit further. Of the poimenoi. And that is poimenoi. Of the flock. So here we have, it says, basically, we have examples. And we have, this is probably an adjective. So being, examples being of the flock. So there we go. So that's basically the first sentence. So elders, that's probably how that comes across. The ones among you. And you could get into some variants if you want. And this is maybe a you all. Because it's a human. And you can get down through there. Okay, let's continue on. And, so let's jump this back over. And, whoops. We're going to continue there. Of the, and we have a comma. We'll break it there. Now, what do we have here? We have a panero centos. And I believe it is in the, oh, it's a genitive, singular, but it's in, yep, genitive case. Archi poimenos. And that is a, of the, so this is a, all this probably connects here. We're going to jump it over to the genitive singular. So it's not a nominative, not accusing, but it's genitive. So we're going to jump it three over. And then here we have, Komi miesete. And that is a verb. This is a future verb. It's plural. And we're going to put that here. And that's just going to be a bold underline of the. And here we have a period. We're going to break that apart again. We have a non-nominative. It's accusative. Very good. And in here, ton, and it goes to an adjective, the incorruptible. So this would be the incorruptible. And this tes doxe, so of glory. And this stephanos, which is a crown. It was the wreath, basically an olive wreath crown. You can get into those things. Okay. And that's basically a transliteration. Stephanos. Well, non. Okay. Continuing on, we start out here in the third sentence, the third Greek sentence here, with an adverb. We're going to jump that over from the nominative and then the adverb place. We have a nominative here. I'm going to jump that over one, and we're going to make that bold. And just to give us a little bit of concept of what was going on, brief translation, this is basically likewise. And it is neoteroi. Likewise, basically it looks like it's plural. So youth. And youth. And I'm going to add this in here just to help us understand it's plural. Youth. Okay, and I'm going to take a brief break, see if there's any questions. Doesn't appear that there are any questions this morning. Well, actually this afternoon. Continue back now here. And we have hupategente presbuterois. So I believe this is a verb. Let's check that out. Yes, we have a verb. It's an imperative. We're going to make it bold, underline, and pink there. And that is going to be someter. Like, oh no, sorry, submit. Basically, if you think about this, you all submit. And interesting here, without getting into too much detail, it's possible that the role of the one over is not to make those under submit, but the ones under are to submit to them. So let's continue on. Presbuterois. Continuing here. Ah, I see. And this is in the dative case. And that basically is to the elders. Or in this particular case, is probably to the overseers or to the elders. And you can get into those things. Okay. Let's continue down here. And this is a, once again, a semicolon, not a period. And that would probably indicate a good time to push things over just one. And I'm going to actually do that up here. That'll make it a little bit clearer. And then this one will go two. Because it's basically one more. There we go. Kind of pushes it over. And we start again here with, and we're going to lose de there at the start, which is and. And all, and this is possibly all men. And this could either be and or but, depends on context. It usually jumps to the front of the sentence here in English, or the front of the phrasing. And let's continue on here. Allelois. And that is dative. We're going to jump that over one, two. So that would be normally against the side, but we, since we jumped it over one, now we go over nominative, accusative, dative. And then we have in here, we go into a nominative case. All men, one another. Allelois. Or common. Or mutually, one another. Let's see that. One another. And then we go in here, hupotestasomenoi. And that one brings us to, it is the being submitted, basically, to one another. And that's just a rough translation. And that is a, like there. And that'll be stay right there. Okay. I see what happened here. This should come over. No, that's right. Okay. And this should jump over one. Continue down here. We have an accusative situation. Whoops, got that just a little bit wrong. And that's the accusative. We'll jump over to the nominative and then the accusative area. Then we will have a verb. And that's already up against its edge there. And that one is also the imperative. We don't want to do that. Bold underline, pink. Just to note that it is in the imperative form. Continue down a little bit further. And this is basically... You all must gird or put on. You all must put on and because or that. This is interesting. This subconjunction could be because or that. It can be some various forms. Continuing God, the God, or God, since we don't tend to translate the article when we're referring to God. And we're going to jump it over one. All this should be bolded. And that's going to go there. And there's a comma section. Now let's see what this is here. Huper eigenois, the sovereign. And we have, and this could be in, to, at, sovereign, I believe. Preeminent. So, and that would be preeminent there. Something like that. That could be adjusted. And then we have nominative, accusative, and dative case there. We're going to look at this verb real quick. And. Oh, I see. And that is actually, looking at this back again, the proud or the haughty. Basically, to italicize because it's not necessarily something in the text there, but we put it that way, to the proud. And it says basically here, God resists. Resists the proud. And remember that de, but, and it could be and, but in this context it'll be but, and we have dative plural masculine, and that is to the humble. So remembering the context of 1 Peter, that they're going through a lot of suffering and different things are hurting them, this is kind of important as you think about different believers in Christ going back and forth, and it's easy to get into a pride situation. And right now, amidst everything going on, and this is going to be gives, it's important not to be prideful or it's important to be humble and remember that God resists the proud but gives grace, and which is going to be the karin, which is the accusative or the direct object, grace. And that should be over one more. And so we went through, we did a brief translation. Some of this you could adjust, of course. It's not a where we're going to would stay with translation, but you can see now, looking through this, we have in here, we have the elders. We have a verb here, an indicative verb here. We have an imperative verb, and we have another verb, and another imperative, and also imperative that's jumped over because of this semicolon. And this kind of helps us go through, visually see where things connect, like these, the but and then neither and things like that. So when you're ready to go through and work on translating or preaching, you have it divided out. And for even here, for example, I know that the periods were and the punctuation was added, but it kind of gives us a good break right here. And we'll divide it there. And then we're going to do another division down here. Let's see, right there. And those are things just to get into. So that's all for today on this short video about sermon preparation and phrasing. I hope it's been helpful, maybe interesting. Thank you for your time, and God bless.